Has anybody heard of Peter Williams? Well, let me tell you a few things you may not know about him. He was born in Geraldine. He was the son of two primary school teachers. And sport was his number one hobby. In fact, he sometimes thumbed through old cricket almanacs for fun. Only to be told he was wasting his time. His broadcasting career began on the school radio station in Painted Post, a village in upstate New York. He spent his final year of high school there on an American Field Service scholarship. And returning home at 18, he narrowly missed the chance to start the university year. And so got a job with Dunedin radio station, well known 4XO. In early 1973, he joined the New Zealand Broadcasting Corporation based in Masterton, Blenheim, Invercargill and Christchurch. And then joined Radio New Zealand Sport, where they taught him to speak properly. In 1979, he scored a job in Sport on One, which was later One World of Sport. In 1995, he was Australian correspondent for One News. In 2002, he took over presenter of Late Night News Show, Late Edition, and then Midday News, and producing Sport for Breakfast and Midday. And then he continued to read the news on the Early Bird show Breakfast with Paul Henry. Some of you will remember those. Peter also wrote a column for the Herald on Sunday for 5 years. After leaving television, he returned to radio, joining the morning team on Magic Radio in January 2019. While there, he drew attention for writing opinion pieces. I mean, he was asked to write opinion pieces, right? He drew attention for writing opinion pieces, questioning the science behind climate change.
Yes.
Shock horror.
Yes.
And defending his right to ask questions about COVID-19. Shock horror. We have got one radical to sit on stage today. And then to sum it up, he joined the board of the New Zealand Taxpayers Union at the beginning of this year. So would you welcome, please, Peter Williams.
Thank you, Bob. Yes, I'm sorry, I confess, I'm an anti-vax, climate-denying racist. So am I. Oh, you want me to stand up?
I was going to say, I ask the questions, buddy. Sit down, right. I ask the questions. Far out. Right.
Well, that's what Willie Jackson called me, so you can understand everything he says and believe everything he says, can't you?
Right, we're going to have some fun. Firstly, I want to ask you about newsrooms, because we watch the news at 6 o'clock, and to be honest, my blood pressure goes up. I can't actually watch it anymore because I just spend the whole time yelling at the TV saying, lies, wrong, fake, not true. What about the other side? So can you give us an insight? I know.
Have you ever thought about talking to your wife and cooking tea at 6 o'clock, Bob?
She says, better for you. She says the same thing. Fake, not wrong. Bob, you're wrong. I can never win. Okay. Can you just take us into a newsroom, and as they're preparing for the 6 o'clock news, and I know you've been out of this a few years and things may have changed. I think we both acknowledge that. But what was the old rule for determining what was news, what wasn't news, and how it was presented, and do you get both sides?
Well, the day started in the newsroom with the 9 o'clock meeting, and in many respects, the most important person at that 9 o'clock meeting was not the producer of the 6 o'clock show, but the person who went under various titles, planning editor, assignments editor, whatever, and they would come with a list of prospects for the day. There would be prospects from Auckland's Wellington Christchurch Bureau, from the Parliamentary Bureau, and all these stories were put into the mix. At the meeting would be reporters, story producers from Auckland. On the line on conference call would be the Wellington and Christchurch and parliamentary people. And it was just a bit of an open session about how stories would be treated, what the angles would be, and that meeting would usually last for around about 20 to 30 minutes, and then everybody would go off and start their day's work, making the phone calls, booking the crews, getting out to interview the people to go and shoot the stories. Now, of course, it's television broadcast news, in fact, the news industry in 2022 with the online scenario that has taken over newspapers, it's a very flexible industry. And you have to react to big weather events, to issues of violence, crime, fires, etc. So nothing's ever set in stone from first thing in the morning. But there is always that, I guess, basic list of stories that you can come back to make up the day's bulletin. And I guess when you've been in the industry for a while, it's just sort of self-evident about what's important and what's not. And then there's another meeting, similar meeting, which reconvenes at 2 o'clock that afternoon. And there are constant discussions during the day as reporters go out on the job, they come back, they talk to producers, they talk to the various people in authority around the newsroom. And it just sort of, I mean, it just sort of happens, I guess is the best way of putting it. But what you're really, I think, angling at is, and bearing in mind, I left in late 2018, so it's coming up 4 years since I worked in the TV One newsroom. I guess what you're angling at is there or was there in those times a determination that every story should be presented in as balanced a way as possible? And I would like to think that most of the time that was happening. Sure, there was always criticism from the people who were affected by the stories about what was right and what was wrong, and that was pretty biased, etc. And even as a news presenter, I could see some stories which made my blood boil, because I thought, that's just patent crap. Because as the newsreader, even though I was the ultimate sub or editor of what words were said by the presenter, and I wasn't beyond changing them live on air, even though they were not in the order queue, you could not make too much difference to the script of the stories that the reporters had presented. So I would like to think that in general, up until 3.5-4 years ago, things were, I won't say exceedingly balanced, but far more balanced than what they are now. And I think the first change came about in the middle of 2019, when there was, for whatever reason, a big move led by Stuff to basically cut out every opposite opinion, dissenting opinion on the matter of climate change. That was the first thing that I saw. And by this stage, of course, I was on talkback radio. So as far as I was concerned, that was just bring it on, baby, bring it on, you know. So there was a week of, I forget the name of the campaign, but Stuff led the way, and there was an international movement from all the usual suspects, the BBC, New York Times, Washington Post, LA Times, Stuff, New Zealand Herald, Radio New Zealand, news organisations all around the world joined in and said, yes, CO2 and emissions are causing the world's climate to go completely skew-whiff, and there shall be no argument against that. That is a scientific fact. And I thought, no. So I started getting people on my radio show like William Happer, Willie Soon, people in the industry, people highly qualified in physics and science who were pushing back against this kind of thinking. To be honest, it was a bit of a whistle in the wind, but I did my bit, and that was, I guess, the start of my notoriety as a conservative and somebody who wasn't thinking the mainstream think that the media, that was demanded of the media. And this was before we had the $55 million public interest journalism fund and the $250 million advertising injection from the government into COVID and various other things.
So, let me come back to that. But just in terms of the newsroom, I mean, was there an understanding that as I said in my presentation at the start, the New Zealand Media Council says that it's supposed to be balanced.
Oh, totally,
supposed to
both
sides of the
Well,
debate.
I would like to think that, particularly in my earlier days, and, you know, I started in television in 1979, and even though I was just in the mere sports department, which as many people regarded sort of as the Arab quarter of the newsroom, that you and that was, seriously, that was a phrase that was used in those days. I was watching what was going on, and even though we know that journalists are traditionally left-wingers, and the number of TV One and media people in general who have gone off to work as press secretaries for the Labor Party outnumbers those who have worked for the National and ACT Party by a ratio, I would suspect, of about 10 to 1. I mean, heaven forbid, some of my old colleagues from TV One News even became MPs. And, you know, Chris Farfour is the most recent example of that. So there was a lot of left-leaning and Labour-supporting people inside the newsroom, and I think it's been that way ever since I started in the industry over 40 years ago.
Well, but could I go back to why? Why are newsrooms filled with left-leaning people? And where are the right-wing people, the Conservatives?
I honestly don't know. Yet there were some notable exceptions to that. Yeah. Dick Griffin, long-serving political editor at Radio New Zealand, then went off to be the chief press secretary for Jim Bolger, National Party Prime Minister in the 1990s, and then went on to chair Radio New Zealand. But I think it's very much a generational thing, and for some reason, and I don't know why, the journalists of the last, 20 years, 15 years, especially the last decade, seem to come in with, maybe it's a case of being indoctrinated at high school or at university or whatever, that this is the way you should think.
Well, you mentioned the word conservative just before, and we've had quite a bit of discussion at Family First and at board level as well about how do you define a conservative? How do you define conservative?
Well,
apart from the thinking word, someone who thinks, what else?
Well, I don't know. What does conservative mean? What does progressive mean? I mean, that's another misnomer that I think is just ludicrous. Why would somebody who supports full-term abortion be called a progressive? I mean, could you be any more regressive than killing a baby at full-term? So why do we have these labels put on people?
I can see why you've been cancelled, because you've got some whack jobs there.
Willie Jackson summed me up perfectly, really.
What did he say?
Well, I'm the anti-vax, climate-denying racist, you know, so.
Now, well, I was going to say, I've got here, I'm sure that even if they didn't say it to your face, you've been called a conspiracy theorist, a bigot, a misogynist, racist. According to Wikipedia, that source of all knowledge and truth, you drew controversy when you directed listeners to the Voices for Freedom group, and in mid-February you questioned the Deputy Prime Minister, Grant Robertson, about his views on the possible implications of the World Economic Forum's Great Reset for New Zealand, in which response Robertson ended his weekly Magic Talk interviews. I was thinking this is one area where I've outdone you, because I managed to hang on to Helen Clark for 4 years on Radio Rima, asking her about whether Jesus actually existed and was he the Son of God. And you can't even hold on to Grant Robertson with the World Economic Forum. So,
what I would say,
one for me,
in my defence, yeah, absolutely, Bob, but I think Helen Clark is a far more, am I going to use the word reasonable, person? I think she is prepared to listen a whole lot more, and she is far more pragmatic in her approach to politics and to life than Grant Robertson is. I remember very early on in this period of Magic Talk with Grant Robertson, and it was a weekly thing on a Thursday morning, there'd been a particular story about him where he said, I believe fundamentally in the role of the state to, what was the word? It wasn't interfere, but it was to assist with the way we live in New Zealand. Basically saying the state should be the overriding organisation, the overriding institution that should control life in New Zealand. Now, to me, that is the complete antithesis of the way that I think. I'm very much in the David Seymour camp. Less government is best government, and I just don't want Grant Robertson interfering, taxing me more, telling me what I can think, what I can't think, denying me certain rights. And I'm frankly not surprised that Robertson in the end just spat the dummy, because what I asked him was about the World Economic Forum and the so-called Great Reset, the World Economic Forum has written and produced videos about the Great Reset, and Klaus Schwab has been the leading light in that, of course. And heaven forbid, Jacinda Ardern herself has spoken at the World Economic Forum. So it's not as if the Labour government is not involved with these people. And for Robertson to just throw a hissy and say that's a conspiracy theory, and then sending an email later that afternoon saying, not coming on your show anymore because I'm not interested in talking about conspiracy theories, I thought, well, so what, mate? I have not lost a moment of sleep over it, I tell you.
So whether it's a politician or any commentator giving you a negative label, it's what Joe Dallas was talking about this morning, is that we don't like the labels, but the labels are designed to shut you up.
Oh, totally. Yeah.
How have you responded to that?
I got to be honest, Bob, but I was listening to Joe with a great deal of interest about that this morning. I quit my job on Magic Talk just on a year ago. In fact, it was, I think, September the 2nd or September the 3rd last year. So it's pretty much 12 months to the day since I stopped working on the radio. And I've been a man of not much courage since, really, in the big issues, because I have to say that when I left, there was a great deal of interest as to why did you leave? And I just turned the phone off and didn't return the calls. Particularly to Stuff, because I just didn't think it was worth engaging with that organisation. I've been asked by various organisations to make speeches, to take part in forums and the like, particularly on COVID-19 matters and on vaccination matters. And I've been less than courageous about it. I finally broke out in June, two or three months ago, and started making some speeches for the Taxpayers Union because I thought I had an obligation to, as a consequence of my being on the board of the Taxpayers Union. So I went off to the southern part of the country, did the same speech five times in 4 days. The reaction to that was just staggering on the Three Waters matters. We had, the last night in Invercargill, we had 550 people in the hall. I was amazed by that. And then I think it was in Gore they recorded it, and it's got up on YouTube or something, and I'm told that it's been seen by 50,000 people. And I never thought too much about the impact that would have, but I would say that even though I've not been looking for attention, somehow the attention is still following me. And then you invite me to come here, and do I button back and not say too much to you, or do I actually tell you my honestly held beliefs? And I think a year on from a media career that lasted nearly half a century, why should I be scared about saying what I think?
And to be honest, it seems like you have got your mojo back, because interestingly enough, you did a recent interview with Sean Plunkett regarding Three Waters, and you said this, you said, quote, "We're fighting a losing battle, but we're not giving up," end quote. I mean, that's the kind of message we're trying to get across today.
Yeah, well, we're fighting a losing battle only because in the House of Representatives there happens to be 65 Labour MPs, and they think as one. But that, I think we all agree, and I'd like to think that in this room we all agree, that that election result in 2020 was a complete and utter anomaly, and that it was an election result bought and paid for by the 1 o'clock press conferences and this fear that was put out into the community about this thing that, you know, gives you a few coughs and a bit of a headache.
But in fairness, you've also got...
Well, that's my experience of it anyway. Yeah. And... And I apologise to anybody in this room who got a bit crook with it, but that was my experience of it.
Yeah.
And I did not get vaccinated, by the way.
See, in fairness, you could say that it was... in fairness, we could say that it was just... it's just because the Labour have got a majority, but the fact of the matter is that even under previous governments, we have had same-sex marriage when National was in power. We have had liberalisation of abortion, we've had euthanasia, we've had banning of conversion therapy, we've had a lot of social engineering that has gone on despite who is the government. So it seems like the whole of Parliament has shifted left.
Yeah, and I suspect that that is Is that because the community has shifted left, Bob? And what has brought that on? I mean, I have been...
Or is it because Conservatives are too quiet?
It may be that, or because they don't get the opportunity to make enough noise. I don't know.
And why don't they get the opportunity? Why don't we get the opportunity?
Because...
Is it because the media won't give us a...
Well, let's look at who the media is controlled by in this country. I mean, it's controlled by journalists who were trained in the... In the 90s, when I started work, and I did not go to university, I went straight from school into the job. In those days, journalists went straight from school to become proofreaders, junior reporters, copy takers, general dog's bodies on newspapers and radio stations. They were never allowed anywhere near actually getting their copy in the paper or... getting their voice on the radio or on the television. They had to do a genuine on-the-job apprenticeship, learning from old grunts who, swore at them, who cut up their copy and said it was a load of crap because it didn't make grammatical sense, let alone having balance. So there was learning from your experienced peers, experienced superiors, was the way that journalism was taught up until when? The big change in the tertiary education industry in this country came along, I guess, under the National Party of the early 90s. They decided that we would have a university degree for pretty much everything. The number of universities in this country expanded from the traditional four or five when Massey came on board. They gave Lincoln College, which had been an agricultural training college, they gave that university status. They gave the Auckland Polytech, the Auckland Technological Institute university status. And all of a sudden, these universities were able to offer degrees in, I say, pretty much everything, including in journalism. Now,
and gender studies.
Yeah, well, maybe people did the same papers on their conjoint degree. I don't know.
Barry Soper was interviewed. Aaron Ironside did an interview for him, and they're both broadcasters.
Yeah.
And Barry admitted that news reporting is becoming dominated by opinion.
Yeah. Well, it is because I think people go into journalism these days on the back of a communications degree. I have no idea what is ever taught in a communications degree. Perhaps somebody should ask the Prime Minister one day, because that, after all, was what she majored in. But they are not taught, as far as I know, particularly in so-called journalism school. They're not taught about how to recognise angles, about what questions to ask, about how to get balance in a story. Mm. I understand, and I could be completely wrong from anybody who's been there, but there's an awful lot of teaching about ideology and about questioning the establishment. Mm. And maybe they're even teaching them about submitting to the establishment as well, and that certainly seems to be the thing that's going on at the moment, because there does not seem to be a lot of hard-out questioning of this particular government's policies, particularly in moral issues that you've been talking about.
And in fairness, it's not just government policy, it's about social debate. I mean, that was one of the arguments during the conversion therapy debate, was there wasn't a lot of questioning about the effect the change in the law would have. I mean, it took seven brave National MPs, were the only ones, to put their hand up and say, hang on, we've got concerns here.
Mm. But with all due respect to that debate, it's something that does not involve a lot of New Zealanders. Unless you're personally affected by it, maybe you're just not prepared to become part of the debate. I mean, Joe was talking before about it's a fact, he says, that 10% of the population is gay. But do we actually survey in the census about whether or not you're gay or whether you, what's that new word, identify as gay? Mm. I don't know. So how do we know? It's purely just a stab in the dark. Mm. And until we actually have some data, we can't say that 10% of the population are gay. So therefore, if 10% of the population are gay, and we don't know, how many of that percentage then want to not be gay? Mm. And the answer is probably...
You're not allowed to say.
Probably not very many. But you're not allowed to say, you're not allowed to ask questions about it. Mm. And also, and this was my big thinking during it, and I heard talkback calls about it, but my own opinion on that particular issue is, well, if people want to be converted, then they are the ones seeking the counselling. Mm. I don't believe there are many people out there actively knocking on doors or in gay communities saying, hey, you know, you come back to being straight. You know, we'll pray away the gay sort of thing. I just don't believe that was happening. I just don't believe it's particularly prevalent in our society. It's like the Safe Spaces Bill regarding abortion clinics. There are not people in the face of women going in to get abortions at abortion clinics up and down the country. But Terry Belichick would tell you the opposite, but because she's had experience of this in the United States. But I just don't see people protesting at women going in to get abortions in this country. And therefore, why do we need to have this particular rule in place to have 150 metres clear space around abortion clinics?
So part of the change, you'll know Simon Collins, who was with the New Zealand Herald,
one of the
reporters that I had a lot of time for and a lot of respect. And when he retired...
He was an old lefty, though, Bob.
He was. But the interesting thing was he still came to us for comment.
Yeah.
Sure, I could see that bias coming through, but at least he gave us the opportunity and the voice to put a contrary opinion.
You see, there's a man who probably left school, went into a smoke-filled newsroom sometime in the late 60s, early 70s. He was trained in the art of journalism by the old hacks, right?
Yeah.
Typewriters making a hell of a noise, ashtrays fuming away. They were dreadful places to work, really. I mean, TV newsrooms are like that as well. We had the ashtrays and the old film can lids.
I did a midnight to dawn shift on ZB one time back in... It was the mid-80s, and Paul Holmes had just started on ZB.
Oh, geez, yeah.
He would arrive at about 3:30 a.m. and he would be literally hunched over this typewriter with the smoke coming out of the room.
Yeah.
And that was tough journalism. But the reason I raised Simon Collins is because he said the problem is that everything is read online, it's instant, and so you just don't have the time to check the facts and represent all sides of the stories. We're trying to beat stuff or RNZ to get things out. You put it up and then you correct it later.
Or we try and put some balance in it later.
Yeah.
But somewhere along the line, didn't he say that some years ago? Somewhere along the line, they just thought, stuff it, that story's gone. It wasn't all that important anyway. We've just said these anti-gay people are weird, so we don't need to get any balance about that. We'll just move on to the next story now. So we'll just so that the original story just stays up, and unless there is the very odd occasion where a conservative voice gets in there, maybe a conservative voice even becomes the headline, you'll find that story is actually taken down. You get a 404. You know, this page no longer exists.
Yeah.
There's an awful lot of that goes on too, isn't there, Bob?
So you wouldn't have been surprised to see in our analysis that there was significant bias in the cannabis debate, abortion debate, conversion therapy.
Well, I found that when I was doing radio during, when was that abortion debate? 2019 was most recent.
Into
2019 into 2020.
March 2020.
I had some... You know, I had a lot of supporters would call me up, but I felt as if I was the place that they could voice their opinion and get listened to. Sure, there were those who were on my case, and you know, I was more than happy to express, you know, my feelings about abortion. And, you know, they're pretty obvious from the views that I expressed in return to them. But there was a good number of callers. And it was a topic that, you know, had plenty of callers banked up. And that's always for a talkback host. You want to see that computer screen full of callers. Because you'll know, Bob, that when you've got a blank screen and it's 10:30 in the morning, you're thinking, I'm going to have to talk to myself for the next 90 minutes. And you get very good at talking to yourself. Because some mornings you just cannot fire the audience up. But that was one topic that did get them going. And I felt that there were far more callers, pro-life callers, to me than maybe any other station because they knew they would get a sympathetic voice.
Well, that's what I was going to say. In fact, when you were on air, it almost became a safe space to hold conservative views, which is interesting.
What's so wrong with that?
Well, that's maybe why you got cancelled.
More to the point, that the emergence of this word safe and unsafe and triggered. I mean, I'm just... What? Where do they come from? I mean, I always thought that being in a safe space was one where, you know, you were going to get love, you were going to get support. The fact that somebody might call you a bloody idiot or that you're a bigot or whatever, that you're a racist even, that's not an unsafe place as far as I'm concerned. That is a place where you can discuss matters, where you can have opinions, where you can have variants of thoughts. What's so wrong with that? What makes those places unsafe where you're expressing an opinion that somebody else doesn't like?
Well, that segues into the question I was going to ask. Paul Moon, we had Professor Paul Moon last year talk about hate speech laws.
Yeah.
And it was interesting. Joe was talking about identifying when you've said something offensive. You won't actually know until you've told that it was offensive. Mm. There's no definition. And that's how our Prime Minister has defined hate speech laws. Yeah. She said, what is hate speech? Well, you'll know it when you see it. That's her definition.
Yeah, well, I would have... I don't know how you can see hate speech, but...
Where's this heading?
Yeah, that's right. You'll know it when you hear it, perhaps, would have been a better way of putting it, Jacinda. Just saying. but it's just total nonsense, what she said, of course. So, I mean, it's completely subjective. And when you are getting to a stage where law is being made on subjective judgments, then you have a real problem with law. I mean, but we've got a history of it in this country, because what was that bizarre phrase that was inserted into the Treaty of Waitangi Act back in 1975 and then reiterated again in 1985 about the principles of the Treaty of Waitangi? Nobody to this day has legislated what the principles of the Treaty of Waitangi are. Therefore, it's been left up to judges to decide, and therefore it's been left up to people to interpret what judges have said, and so we're away on that particular train, aren't we?
And it's interesting you raise that, because you did a very good interview with Ewan McQueen, who's here, on his book about the Treaty of Waitangi, and it's definitely worth a listen. Mm. Can I just talk about the intersection of faith and politics?
Mm-hmm.
Well, firstly, seeing you're being so honest today, that's lovely.
The answer is, born a Presbyterian, raised a Presbyterian. My father was always an elder in the Presbyterian churches when we moved around as a family of school teachers. Bearing in mind that my mother, my father, my sister, and my late first wife were all school teachers. So I lived with school teachers for the first 42 years of my life. So anybody who says you don't know what teaching's like, well, maybe not in the last 25 years, but certainly up until about 1996, I know what teaching was like. I was born and raised a Presbyterian, went to Sunday school, Bible class, and frankly, by the age of 17, got a bit bored with it all. So went off.
Into New York?
Well, yeah, I was in upstate New York for a year, came back, went working, and faith and God and church, and I just didn't care about it, really. It had not been particularly thrilling or enlightening for me in my teenage years. Then when I was 22, Cecile and I were married. She came from a big Dutch Catholic family, and she was one of seven kids, and they were a good Catholic family, and Catholicism was very important to her. And we were having our first child, 1978, so that was, a year and a half or so after we got married. And Cecile said, well, you know, I want our son. No, I don't think we knew what it was at that time. We want our child to be raised as a Catholic. And I thought about that and said, of course, it makes sense, because your parents are very deep in the Catholic faith. And, you know, was it the easy way out? It was certainly a very pragmatic and practical thing to do. The old story, if you can't beat them, join them. So, much, I won't say to the chagrin, but much to the surprise and the eye roll of my parents, I jumped the fence. I went from being a right footer to a left footer. And
as I say, happy wife, happy life.
Precisely, yeah. And actually, I found inside the Catholic Church for some years real comfort. And particularly when Cecile died, 20 years later, it was a real source of comfort, both to me and to the kids who had all gone to Catholic schools, that we had this faith to somehow think that for whatever reason, Cecile had been taken from us. And we don't know why, but it was, we took satisfaction and some comfort in the fact that for whatever reason, it was his will that, she would leave us at the age of 42.
Mm. Yeah. So we're just about out of time, but can I just give you two scenarios? Christopher Luxon, in his maiden speech, said, "My faith is personal to me. It's not in itself a political agenda. I believe no religion should dictate to the state. No politician should use the political platform they have to force their beliefs on others." But then you've got British politician and anti-slave trade campaigner William Wilberforce, who said, "I would suggest that faith is everyone's business. The advance or decline of faith is so intimately connected to the welfare of a society that it should be of a particular interest to a politician. A private faith that does not act in the face of oppression is no faith at all." Which side would you come down on that?
Well, I could do a real Christopher Luxon and say somewhere in the middle. And not commit to anything. I mean, let's face it, Wilberforce lived at a time when faith was a far more integral part of people's lives, didn't he? And, he was the great campaigner for maybe the worst injustice that has ever existed in the Western world. And, he was able to use faith to say that this is just not fair to these people who are slaves. Luxon, I think Luxon is just being pragmatic. He knows that if his faith was exposed, as it may well be, in fact, I have no doubt that sometime in the next year before the election, that there will be somebody making in-depth investigations into his church and into the activities he's got up to in this church. But I've always thought that the best politicians are the honest politicians, and that's why I admired Bill English so much, because he was not afraid to say that Catholicism mattered to him, and he obviously lived the life of a good Southland Catholic, and even though he was a National Party MP and a National Party minister, he stuck to his faith-based principles with looking after the individuals and not going all-embracing and spending millions of wasted taxpayers' dollars. But his social investment approach was something that the country has been sadly missing for the last 5 years.
Yeah. So you've segued into my final question, and that is that it seems that, like, being a conservative or a person of faith is persona non grata in our culture. I mean, we've been talking about that a lot.
Yeah.
Cancel culture. You have experienced some of that cancel culture.
Yeah.
So my question to you is, what's your advice for us? How do we have influence in the public discourse on conservative issues, not be afraid of the labels, realising that sometimes we have to step into the fire?
I mean, I've been asked this question a bit. How do we push back against the obvious left-wing anti-Christian religion of the New Zealand media? The only way you can do it, in reality, Bob, is either to have a few hundred million splashing around and start your own organisation, and be prepared to invest and invest and invest. Now, Sean Plunkett is doing a little bit down that line, but sooner or later, the rights who are backing that venture, the platform, are going to say, okay, we need a bit of a return on investment here. So there is that way. So is there somebody who is prepared to invest hundreds of millions of dollars in a major media organisation in this country and make it a big-time media organisation across a number of platforms to be able to push back against what's going on? And it's going to take some time. I mean, Fox News was not a success overnight, but that came along with the Murdoch, the billions of the Murdoch empire behind it. So it's either doing that Or else, and this is possibly more nefarious, is somehow we get some conservative minds into positions of power in our major media organisations. And I think option one would be a downside easier if a lot more expensive.
Right. Peter, thank you for your time. Let's thank Peter Williams. Well done. Thank you.
Thank you.